Hello everyone, I Janya Sharma welcome you all in today's session of webinar. The topic for today's talk will be Fail Safe Philosophy, an inevitable part of the safety system's reliability. Safety has always been a great matter of concern everywhere. In 2018-19, railways recorded 16 deaths, 28 deaths were recorded in 2017-18, and 195 deaths in 2016-17. You guys won't believe, there was a time between 1990 to 1995, an average of more than 500 accidents took place every year, with around 2,400 deaths and 4,300 injured in those 5 years. A decade later, between 2013 to 2018, an average of around 110 accidents took place every year, which killed around 900 people and injured about 1,500 people, according to data available at PTI. But do you know, there were zero, absolutely zero accidents in the year of 2019. So we can say that 2019 has been the safest year for railway passengers. If we observe the death rate graph, it has been continuously decreasing. So we can say that the safety measures have been continuously increasing day by day. Well, I can't explain you the deep insight of the railway security and safety system. So today we have Dr. C. Ravi Kumaran Nair. He is an officer in the cadre of Indian Railway Services of Electrical Engineers, currently working as a senior divisional safety officer in Indian Railway. Dr. Nair is head of safety department, Railway Division, Thiruvananthapuram. Previously, he has worked as an engineer at field units for 14 years, assistant executive engineer for around 3.5 years, executive engineer for around 8.5 years, and worked at deputy chief engineer level from 27th August 2018 onwards. He is an engineer and a PhD holder by profession, a gold medalist in officers training at National Academy of Indian Railways, Vadodara. Received 10 awards, including award from Union Railway Minister too. He has many research papers to his credit in national and international journals of repute, including SCI Journal. We welcome you, sir. We also welcome Dr. Harish Mittal, Principal BMIET, Dr. Abhinav Juneja, Associate Director, BMIET, Dr. Vishal Jain, Dean, Academics, BMIET, and all our fellow students and professors. So now, hold your seat and get ready to go through a very exciting and knowledgeable session ahead. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, everybody. I think I am audible to all.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So, once again, good morning to the principal of the institute, other faculty members, my dear friend, Dr. Vishal, other staffs, and my dear students. I am Dr. Ravi Kumaran Nair, an officer of Indian Railway Service of Electrical Engineering on JAG. And I'm having a PhD degree in Power System Engineering. So today, it's a special day for me because I am completing 28 years of my service in Indian Railway today. So I am much obliged, or I am owing to the public of India, who are represented to the central government, for giving me the opportunity to serve the nation. Thank you. Now, today, my subject in the webinar is the fail-safe philosophy in safety system. I'm having certain reason for selecting this topic. Actually, I'm not focusing on any specific area because this madam that introduced that there are a lot of safety issues here in Indian Railway, but I'm not focusing on Indian Railway, but I want to say to the students who are the promise of the future, how to design a safety system. Because I can see that a lot of innovations and inventions are coming up from the college campus all over in the India. I'm also getting many such project works for evaluation also. I'm very regret to say that most of them, having no comprehensive lookout in designing such idea into innovations. So today, I want to say, what are the essentialities to be incorporated in designing a safety system? So that is the fail-safe philosophy. Is the screen is visible to you? I think now the screen is visible to you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So actually, I'm going through this fashion only because I think certain technical problem is facing by my laptop. So I will go to this level only. See, all this part we have already covered. And it's a definition of the fail-safe. It is very simple. It is a design feature or practice that in the event of a specific type of failure, inherently responds in a way that will cause no or minimal harm to other equipment, to the environment, or to people. So what is the philosophy? The system being fail-safe does not mean that the failure is impossible or improbable, but rather that the system's design prevents or mitigates unsafe consequences of the system failure. Because any failure can happen to any system in an unanticipated way also. So in failure-safe system, if and when a fail-safe system fails, it remains at least as safe as it was before the failure. Here, one thing is to be specifically noted that the safety system will always be a subsystem of the main system. It can be in different forms. So it can be some particular scheme of working of the subsystem, or it can be some sets of sequential operational procedures, or it can also be the actuation of a self-destructing module within the system itself. The last one, which I mentioned, is exclusively applicable for some space exploration, like, because see, some rockets are being launched, and if it goes beyond the control, definitely that will be a safety hazard. So as some destructive system will be integrated within on board, so that system will get actuated, and the blasting may happen at the space itself. So this last one normally will not be applicable for a social safety systems. Now see, this is the golden rule of fail safety system. It's a golden rule. If functioning of a safety system is stopped by any reason, functioning of the main system is also to be stopped immediately. This is the philosophy. Here, some doubt may arise. See, in information technology area, there is some fail safe system is there. But what they mean is they are making the copies, or they are copying the files to some other storage places. So actually they are only duplicating it or making some additional storage. But that is not meant here in safe, fail-safe system of safety. Because if the functioning of the safety system is stopped by any reason, functioning of the main system is also to be stopped immediately. So let us check it. See, a simple example, a car. I've just shown the functioning part of the car only. Engine is there, steering is there, drive wheels are there, brake will be there, shock absorbers, so many. So car is a system. Its main function is to move on the road. Its main function is to move on the road. It has many subsystems like engines, wheels, shock absorbers, headlights, brake, steering. Brake, steering, and headlights are the safety systems, and brake system is the most important among them. Now we are focusing on the brake system. See, this is the normal braking system. The vehicle stops when the brake shoe strongly press on the rotating wheel drum with a connected piston moving inside the brake cylinder with a brake power, brake application by the driver. See here, this is a brake cylinder, brake piston is there, this is brake shoe, and this is the brake drum connected to the wheel, and some compressed air, or it can be fluid also. So by application of the pedal, brake pedal, the fluid or will come, or compressed air will come inside, it will push the piston towards, and it will strongly press on the drum. So obviously the wheel, rotating wheel, decelerated, it come to a halt. Not normal one. Now just think, what will happen if some failure happens in this area? The compressor fluid may, say it may leak out. The compressor air may, it may also leak out. If it leaks out, what will happen? So brake application will fail. The vehicle could not be stopped with the brake application. So here, even though the brake system is the safety system incorporated here in the vehicle, a failure happened in the brake system is not able to control the main function of the vehicle, and vehicle will move as before, and it could not be stopped in the event of an accident. So this system is not a fail-safe system. Now let us think of a different system. See here, the piston is here, the same arrangement is here. Instead of pressing it, the brake shoe is always in pressed condition to the drum. Means without releasing the brake shoe, the wheel drum could not be rotated. Means brake in the normally applied condition. Here another system is there to give the compressed air or fluid inside here. Here this chamber, it is a high pressure fluid may be there, or compressor spring will be there. So it will have always a tendency to press this piston towards the brake drum. So without releasing it, that vehicle could not be moved. So the vehicle, now in this system, the vehicle can start only when a high pressure is applied on the piston in the opposite direction, this direction, and thereby releasing the brake. Now just think, what will happen if the fluid, high pressure fluid, or the compressed air is leaked out? Nothing will happen. The high pressure chamber here, it will exert pressure on this piston, and it will retain its original position, that is the brake applied position. Means whenever the brake system fails, the main function of the vehicle itself is stopped spontaneously, or says automatically. So this is a fail-safe system. Actually, this braking system is applicable in very long-hauled vehicles, especially on trains. In trains, this kind of braking system is adopted. Okay, now we will go to some other example. See, you can see two signals. It's a very old type signals only. Nowadays, the color red signals are given. I have given this just because of better understanding. Two arms are there. This we call it as a semaphore arms. Semaphore arms. So two lines, you can see these two lines, this traffic of two railway tracks at the stations are controlled by two distinct semaphore, one and two. Signals are provided to correctly communicate the stop and start instructions to the drivers without ambiguity, because very clear, driver on this left hand side track, he knows that this signal belongs to him, and driver on this train, he knows that this signal belongs to him. So there is no ambiguity. As both the tracks join together, after a few meters, only one train can start from the station at a time. This is a normal arrangement. Now, see, this is the position of the signal. Let the horizontal position of the semaphore implies a stop signal. It's a horizontal position. A lever or a wire rope will hold the horizontal position of the semaphore rope. Some arrangement will here, it will hold its horizontal position. If you release it, it will droop. And drooping of the semaphore arm, or by releasing the lever or wire rope, is a signal to give the start signal to the train from the corresponding railway track. So this is a convention of signals. Now we are going to a scenario. See, two trains are waiting at the two tracks. This is a station. So these both the tracks will join together, and only one train can start at a time because the path is only available for one train. Now to see, this is a stop signal. This is also a stop signal. Now the station master want to start the train from the this right hand side track, for which see he has given the stop signal. The semaphore is drooped. So the station master gives a start signal for the train waiting for right hand side track. Now the train will start from the right hand signal. Just think, let us assume that the lever or the wire are up holding the horizontal position of the semaphore signal of the left hand side is broken. It is a failure. It's a safety system failure. It happened. Maybe due to any reason, maybe that wire is corroded or some disengagement of the connecting parts happened. Anyway, it is failed. So it will also droop. So the semaphore will droop down as a result of it. Now see, it's a dangerous condition. The driver of the train waiting on left side track may interpret it as a start signal for his train also. And if he starts the train at this juncture, the train collision is imminent here. So here the failure of the signaling scheme proves to be disastrous. So this is not a fail-safe safety system. It is not a fail-safe safety system. Why it has happened? The design of the signaling system is not fails. It's not foolproof. The designer did not comply with the fail-safe philosophy in the design. In such a signaling scheme, some additional safety procedures or equipments are essentially to be incorporated to the start from any of the track. So this signaling scheme alone is not sufficient to start the train safely. So some additional systems in railway, we call it as a block instruments, it is there. But with the mere the signaling scheme, the train could not be starts because it is not fail safe. Now let us think in a different angle. See, as before, the horizontal position of the signal is stop. It implies a stop. So it will not droop down because a stopper is placed there, because this is a normal position. And the raising of the semaphore with some lever or wire rope is given as a signal to start the train from the corresponding railway track. So this is the start signal. This is stop as before. So this is the difference we had made now. Now what will happen? See, two trains are waiting the station. Start signal is given for the train to start from the track number 2. So the train from the track number 2, right hand side track, it will start. Say here the wire rope or the lever connecting the controlling the movement of the semaphore is failed. What will happen? It will droop. The right hand side will signal will droop. See, this will be the ultimate position of it. Both will be in the horizontal position, means both implies the stop signals only. Stop signal means no train can start. So it doesn't request any additional safety equipments to control the movement of the train safely. So here it is a fail safe because the signal system is failed. But spontaneously or simultaneously, the whole function of the railway system is also stopped, because railway system means its main function is to run the train. It is stopped fully. No train can start from any other track. Incoming supply, bus bar is there, two transformers are there, so many feeder lines are there. So each feeder line's supply is being controlled by the circuit, corresponding circuit breakers. So in the event of a fault on any of the feeder line, the corresponding circuit breaker, CB means circuit breaker, that will trip the electric supply with the actuation of the protection relays. There will be so many protection relays. We call it as a earth fault relay or overcurrent relay, short circuit relay, etc. Many relays are there. So any of the relay will actuate as per the nature of the fault. And with the actuation of the relay, the circuit breaker will trip. How it trips? See, here this is the circuit of the tripping circuit. This is the tripping coil. Tripping coil means it's an electromagnetic coil. Inside there will be a plunger. So when it gets a DC supply, that with the magnetic field, that plunger will move out. It will hit on a latching mechanism, opening latching mechanism of the circuit breaker. And with that opening of the latching mechanism, circuit breaker will open and the supply to that feeder line will get interrupted. And see here, the most safe element is the battery. Because if and only if the battery is there, this will actuate. The trip coil will actuate. And the protection relay is giving only a switching action. You can see it. It gives only a switching action. If some fault is there, protective relays will act. It will give a switching action and it will close this switch. That's all. But actually, the tripping coil is being actuated with the battery voltage. So it is the most important element in this protection system. Now let us see what will happen. See, the battery supply is failed, or if it is low, the voltage is low. Now assume. So what will happen at this juncture? The tripping coil will not get energized even when the protection relay are actuated on feeder fault condition. So circuit breaker will remain in closed position, means supply will go through. See what will happen. If it's a short circuit, means enormous current will pass through the feeder line. So the feeder line and associate equipments will burn, it will melt. So it's a highly dangerous condition. So this is happened only because this battery is failed. So there is no, it is, so we can say that this is not a fail-safe system. Now let us add some more feature with it. See, we are connecting a capacitor, electrolytic capacitor across the battery. So long as the battery is healthy, this capacitor will also get fully charged. So it will act as another voltage source. And a conductor is also given in parallel to the battery. It will always in holding position. If this conductor is holding position, means this is, it's normally closed contact, so it will be in open condition. If this is in holding position, means this conductor will be in the open position. And normally this conductor will also be in open position. So the tripping coil will not get any supply to actuate it in normal condition. Now, some failure happens. So this will close and this circuit will be closed. A current will constitute through, it will flow through the tripping coil. So it will get energized, plunger will act. It will hit on the opening latch of the circuit breaker. Circuit breaker will open. Supply will be interrupted. Now, let us think, what will happen if the battery voltage is failed all of a sudden or come to a low level? See, there was a capacitor fully charged. It will not discharge through the battery because a diode is given. So that voltage will be there. But what happened to this conductor? This conductor will de-energize. So this conductor. So this switch will close, this conductor will close. It will constitute a closed path. See, a closed path through this capacitor. So capacitor will act as a voltage source momentarily, and a current will set in the coil, tripping coil, and coil will actuate and it will hit on the plunger will hit on the opening mechanism of the circuit breaker and circuit breaker will open. So it will happen only once that DC voltage is low or it is failed. So if the DC voltage fails, immediately this tripping coil will get energized through the capacitor and that will open the circuit breaker, means the main function of the power system means to the give the power supply, that will be stopped immediately. So this is a fail safe system. So now, why I had mentioned this, whenever our students, they are designing some safety system, the faculties may kindly look into whether this is complied with the fail-safe system. Because you can see in Indian Railway, actually we are having a lot of safety rules, safety equipment, so many things. So many innovations are being presented to our table also for the comments and approval. We are just examining whether the presented scheme or the submitted scheme is a fail-safe complied or not. It's not complied, fail-safe complied, definitely it cannot be a process for further level. So why the reason for it, this fail-safe philosophy is ignoring? These are the reason. See, lack of understanding about the prevailing system. Actually, for designing safety system for any system, a complete understanding about the main system is necessary. So the inventor has, or the researcher has to spend reasonable time within the main system to know what are the safety hazards encountered by the main system. So without that, the lack of ability to assess the consequential effects of the safety system failure. So the inventor may design some safety system, but they have to assess the ability. What will happen to this safety system if it is failed consequentially? That's very important. And another thing is dishonoring the failure mitigation rules and practices. There are a lot of rules are there. Safety rules are there. We can simply see in our main switches in our home. See, the switch, some fuses will be there inside that main switches. We cannot extract out that fuse without opening the main front door of that main switch. But for opening the front door of it, we have to lower the handle lever. While we are lowering the handle lever, the supplier will be switched off automatically to the fuse unit. Then only we can insert our hand inside. So the exposed portion will not be there if that lever is lowered. So it is a fail-safe system. So such rules are already there. We can see such a lot of rules there in Indian Electricity Rules, University Act and Boilers Act, then Factories Act. So many rules are there. So we have to fully study the aspects of each and every safety rules and the failure mitigation rules and practices. Here I want to mention about one incident just happened to that Singapore Lion Air. So while it's some incident has happened because it was crashed in the midair. It was similar incident happened to the Ethiopian Airlines also. So some system, some 50 old year design, they have incorporated some safety features. That is, when it's taking off, normally the pitch, that means the angle of attack will also go up. So that will give more air friction. So it is to be adjusted, it is to be lowered, for which a system they have developed and incorporated with, and that system was fully made automized with a sensor. So what happened is, when this sensor give a erratic signal, because whenever it is giving, when it is flying in horizontal also, that sensor says that, see, it is in a pitch up position. So what it will give a corrective signal to low down the pitch. So ultimately what happens, because of the wrong signal given by the sensors, the pitch was continuously reduced by the controlling system, incorporated controlling system itself. And finally what happened, it is just that plane was nosedive. So it was fully crashed. Actually, there was a safety, that the safety hazard mitigation practice was also incorporated. It was not sort of at that time, because if some abnormality faces, the loco pilot was able to bypass that system, but he failed to do it also. That is what I'm saying. The dishonoring of the failure mitigation rules and practices is it is dangerous and disastrous. So that also to be taken account while designing a safety system. And say integration of different component of different vulnerabilities without clearly defining the preventive maintenance practices. See, we have seen that in our power system, that capacitor tripping device was given. The capacitor, we know that it is capable of charging the electric charge, it is capable of charging it, but it can also fail. But capacitor will not fail all of a sudden. What we have to do is, and the battery itself, that will also not fail all of a sudden. So those two items are highly vulnerable there. Well, it is vulnerable. So its health condition should be maintained perfect, intact, for which laid down maintenance practices will be there, and that maintenance practices should be meticulously followed. Meticulously followed, should not ignore it. So what we have to do is try to integrate the components in the safety system, which is having almost the same durability, and same dependability also. Better to avoid the quick failing components. And the foremost thing is, that important thing is, see, every fail-safe system will be expensive. That extra cost involved in making a system fail-safe complete is thought of as a wasteful expenditure in that juncture. So definitely it will be expensive only. So now, how the system can be made fail-safe? First of all, clearly understand the main system and then define the purpose of each component of the safety system. Here, one thing we have to bear in mind, that the safety system, I have already mentioned that it's a subsystem, but a safety system is may not be common for all part of the main system. Individual part of the main system may require distinct safety system also. So we have to study the system, the main system, very well, then define the purpose of the components of the safety systems, and enumerate the possible failures that can hamper each components of the safety system. So I think it is very clear that point. And consider the environment as an important cause of failure of any safety system. Here I want to specify 2-3 points. See, in some contacts or some capacitors or some other electronics items that we are using for making the safety systems, the air humidity or humidity in the air is a factor of its durability. See, in Kerala, I can see that it is 80 to 90% humidities are in the air. But whereas in the north states, Rajasthan, or at that area, humidity is very less. Similarly, the salinity in the air at the coastal area will be very higher, but it will be almost zero at the mid part of in India. So if we are designing the safety system for the same main system for different part of the country, the safety system may not be apt for every climatic condition or environmental condition. So it should be customized. So better, while you are making a system fail-safe or you are designing a fail-safe safety system, go to the place where the main system is going to be established and study about the environment also, so that you can assess the vulnerabilities caused by the environment also. Now, the legislation made to create fail-safe system should be free from any ambiguity. It's very clear because see, the legislations or the rules, they are made for the safe operation of any systems. There will be some do's and don'ts. Strictly, those do's and don'ts should be complied with the design of the fail-safe system. And finally, the fail-safe compliance of a system will always be expensive, that I already told. Never ever think that the extra cost involved in making a system fail-safe compliant is a wasteful expenditure. So here, I would like to finish my PowerPoint. Actually, I had made this PowerPoint to make the awareness among the undergraduate engineering students, those who want to design some safety system for us also. Please keep these points in mind, for which only I had given some 2-3 example for it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing your knowledge with us. Right now we have so many questions in our chat box. We will try to take up the queries one by one. So the first question is by Saurabh Jain, student BMIET.
Pardon? Because I am having some hearing problem.
Sir, we have the question session right now. So the first question is by the student BMIET, Saurabh Jain.
Okay. Welcome. Yes, welcome, dear. Please start. No, it's not audible.
Good morning, sir. My name is Saurabh.
Good morning.
I'm from CC7, sir. I'm skilled in machine learning and Python. My question to you, sir, is when we will correlate to the actual reliability of life critical system? We design, test the systems. Even after that, sometimes system fails in family and environment too. Why is it so?
See, the main purpose of this presentation is to make you aware about what are the factors to be considered or to be taken care of while designing a fail-safe system. So I am not an expert in other than electrical engineering. So my advice to you is to go to the actual environment and see what are the possible failures. Because I have given an advice. Go to there and see what are the vulnerabilities exist in the main system and what may be the probable cause of failure when you are designing a system. So I cannot specifically say without seeing the system what are the advice to be given to you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So now I request Ashi, student BMIET, to please put up your question.
Good morning, sir. My name is Ashi and I am doing BTech in CSE branch. And my question to you is, sir, what is the level of testing used in railway networks and how often do we test the network to ensure the safety of passengers?
That level of testing, you mean? What do you mean about the standard of testing?
Yes, sir. And what, like, how often does the safety is taken care?
Yes. So standard of testing, actually, it is decided at the railway's own design and standard organization. I think you might have heard of it, RDSO. Yes. And there is no customized standard of testing for newly innovated items. So for the existing items, safety items, there are, see, ISO is one among them. So IEC is one among them. And the IEEE standard will be there. So many testing guidelines are available with us. So it is not, it is cumbersome to enumerate all those things. So I advise you to better go through the site available on it. It is available on the public domain.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The next question is by Nikhil Jain, student BMIET.
Good morning, sir. My name is Nikhil Jain, and I am the CSC student. And I have, my question is to you is that what are the prospects for the engineering graduate in railways, and how one can pursue his or her career option in railways?
Actually, that is beyond the scope of our presentation now, I think. Anyway, as a common man, I can say there are many level of recruitments are there. Since you are an engineer, better you can go for UPSC examination, engineering service examination, which is conducted by UPSC, so that you can enter in railway as an assistant executive engineer level directly, in class one level directly, with a title as IRS, EE or IRS like that. You can get in.
Okay,
and another lower level is there. That is recruitment to railway recruitment board. So there they will recruit engineers from the market.
Okay.
You can apply because that UPSC that every year their calendar that there is a calendar of recruitment is there. Then railway recruitment board they will notify it, apply for it, and appear for the competitive examination. And I would like to recommend you to join railway because your career in railway will be challenging, no doubt, because it is an ocean. You can see.
Thank you so much.
Just like Mahabharata, you can see anything. You can look at anything from it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next question is by another student of BMIET, Rajat.
Sir, my question to you is, railways are emerging as safer mode of transport in recent few years.
Can you increase your audio level?
Sir, railways are emerging as safer mode of transport in recent few years. What has changed in these years which has decreased the rate of accidents and fatalities?
Please start from the beginning.
Okay, sir, my question is, railways are emerging as safer mode of transport in recent few years. What has changed in these years which has decreased the rate of accidents and fatalities caused? Like, what are the technologies and methods taken to reduce the accidents in past few years?
The question is very interesting and very important, especially connected to the contemporary situations. Of course, I have already told you that there are lot of legislations, laws, rules, which governs the safe operation of each and every equipment. So I can say that the most of the accident happens in the past where because of the human failure. Because the human being are operating all these things in many of the things. So it was human failure in many cases. So ultimately what we have found out in through the investigation that disregarding or dishonoring the safety procedures of those systems. And now see from the corporate level, from the highest level itself, special safety drives are being enforced. Periodically, every month we are getting special safety drive from our apex level, and we are communicating to the field level through the different hierarchy, and we are seeing that they are being actually followed up, and we are sending the report also back. So obviously, when somebody is there to watch or somebody is there to monitor any system, its efficiency will get improved. And the failure chance will come down. So that is the methodology nowadays we are implementing. And along with it, modernization of the safety systems are also there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Urvashi, student BMIET, to please put up your question.
Good morning, sir. I am Urvashi, civil 7th SAM from BMIET. So my question to you is, can we assure a 100% fail-safe system in its span?
No, because 100% failure system, fail-safe system means it is a hypothetical one. It's a hypothetical one, because we human being only designing fail-safe systems. The human being only. So the inherent inability of the human being to make anything 100% perfect will reflect in our design also. But I'm sure that we can make it almost perfect fail-safe system if we dedicate our time and our resources in the research time. That is what I told you. Try to study the system at a grassroots level and to assess and try to assess the vulnerabilities to the maximum possible extent. Then we will get almost perfect failure safe system. Thank you.
Welcome, sir. So I have one more question. Sir, why don't we improve in the derailment of tracks? Because most of the accident in our country is due to that reason.
Sir,
realignment of tracks.
Realignment?
Yes, sir.
No. I don't accept that. I advise you to go to a nearby railway division and have a discussion or have a chat with the senior divisional civil engineer. Senior divisional engineer will be there.
Yes. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello.
We
have Dr. Suresh Vishwakarma. He has joined us from Vancouver, Canada. He wished to ask a question. I am unmuting Dr. Vishwakarma. He'll ask question directly, sir. He's on Zoom with sir.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Over to you, Suresh, sir.
Hello.
Good morning, Suresh, sir. I think you may be knowing well. Because I am also a member of that our UPS PhD group.
Yeah. Can you believe it is 11:20 p.m. here. 11:20 p.m. and I'm still holding awake just for the want sir, of you, hearing you.
Sir, you know that I am from railway service. Yeah. And see, our clock is of 24 hours. We don't have an a.m. or p.m.
I have also spent my entire life in utility company. So for us, we work 24/7, 7 days in a week. Okay, anyway, without taking time of everyone, let me first thank Vishal, because he is the one who introduced me to BMIT. And since then, he is not leaving me. And every time he has been inviting me and he wants me to contribute, and I'm happy also. Just wanted to have your opinion. In fact, it is a question, general question for everyone, that two things. Definitely, there must be some drawbacks and limitations of implementing this fail-safe philosophy in railway power system during your long career of about 28, 30 years, what you said. Did you find that this philosophy, yes, of course, it is giving some advantage, but does it have any limitation or some sort of drawbacks also, that eventually, you know, it is sometimes it our efficiency is compromising because of that? Yes, Very quick answer. Yes, I'm not asking for a detailed explanation.
Yes, it happens, because I will say just with an example. See, yeah. I have already shown that the circuit breaker, if that DC supply fails, it will trip. So this entire supply will fail in the traction field. So what will happen if some train is hauling up?
Yeah.
It is powering up in the up gradient.
Yeah.
So that will come to a halt.
Exactly, and a lot of inertia will be there, and then it will be very difficult. It will be very difficult, yeah.
Because it will come to a halt if that power failure prolongs, and it will stall there. And when it is further powering is there, it may grind the track also.
Yeah.
The scabbing will be on the track. So definitely some defects are there. That is what I am saying, sir. Nothing can be made 100% fail safe.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Does it sometime ends up into a situation where there is a huge public unrest and public gets really angry because of the delay or some sort of situation is caused because of having this system in place? Because this happens in our power system very frequently. Whenever there is any lightning, whenever there is any inclement weather situation, there is a cascade effect. A number of breakers and relays, they will keep on tripping, and eventually who will suffer? The customers will suffer. So this happens with you also?
But sir, in railway system, I can say that our power failure rate is very, 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 very low, very low. We are having alternative feed arrangements. Alternative feed arrangements we have. If the zonal grid is failed, then only we will fail such. But what that happens once in a blue moon.
And another question I had, in fact, directly sent to you and Vishal also, that, you know, there are two type of system. One is fail safe and second is safe to fail. So how do you think this, you know, where do you find a sort of break even between fail safe and or over safe to fail? Which one, given a choice, which one would you prefer to implement?
Sir, is there any difference between the philosophy of these two? I don't feel
so. You know, safe to fail means, you know, designing your signal system in such a way that any potential error will also not result in any accident.
That is fail safe, we say.
No, fail to safe. You know, it is safe to fail. Yeah. Fail safe, it is, that means the equipment.
No, sir, it is fail to safe means I want to say with an example for an aircraft. See, it's some safety system, say it is failed. So it is better to fail the entire system before taxiing itself. So it is better to fail to save the system, not fail safe system, but is, so that is there. But in our signaling system, we are going for the fail safe system. Because if signal fails, definitely the total traffic will be interrupted, and we will deal the traffic with through some manual arrangements with the strict rules and observations.
That means safe to fail is not an option for you.
Definitely not.
Recently I had actually attended one seminar on this, and there was a good debate on that. Anyway, thank you very much for answering my questions. Thank you, you can take other questions, the students, questions of other students. Sir. Thank you, Vishal.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Vishal,
sir, you're not audible to us.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Out of hundreds of viewers on the Facebook, one of the students, he wished to ask one question. Though it is out of context of the current topic of the webinar, he wished to ask why we can't run bullet train in India.
Sorry. I cannot at this level, because I am only a public servant, even though I'm an IRC officer. I'm a public servant.
It's out of the protocol. Yes.
No. Even that I can personally, I give my opinion to you, but not through this media. Sorry.
No problem, sir. Jania, please carry on.
Thank you, sir, for clearing all our queries by answering all our questions. So now I would like to ask our Dean, academics, Dr. Vishal Jain. So would you like to share some of your words with us?
Yeah, Jania, just at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Ravi Kumar Nair. On just a mere request, he took out time out of his busy schedule, and all the way making so many presentations, so many slides. And he consented very kindly to be a part of our institute at the webinar. And I'm again really grateful from the management, student, staff. I think 100 and 1,000 of students are viewing it now. And definitely this philosophy, they will incorporate in their career. And also they will opt the Indian Railways as one of the career. And maybe they would like to contact you on email. I will definitely share your email with them, so that should they have any query, they would ask you on email. So once again, thank you so much, Ravi sir. It was really great to see you.
Thank you,
sir. Now, it is the time to mark the ending of such an interesting, exciting, and knowledgeable session. Thank you all for being such a great and supportive audience to us. And a special thanks to our guest today, Dr. C. Ravi Nair. See you all in the next session. Thank you all for joining us today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jania, for being a wonderful host. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.